Hello and welcome to BusyWorksBeats.com. Today we continue the OVO series here at BusyWorksBeats.com/OVO. Today we're going to go over how to create the deep, emotional, atmospheric sound for Drake. So we're going to go over some sound design techniques. We're going to start with chords, and then we're going to lead into the rest of the song. In an interview, I can't remember exactly which one, maybe with Pensado's Place, Noah Forty Shabib was talking about how he creates his song with the music first and then adds the drums later. And this creates a different dynamic of how you approach your music, believe it or not. Chords coming before the drums usually mean you're going to focus on the musicality of it more, and you're going to find the rhythm inside the pad and the music itself. If you start with the drums first, I'm saying this lightly, you're a slave to the rhythm. Okay, and I don't mean that in a negative way. I mean, the rhythm dictates the way you play your chords. If it's a very upbeat rhythm, you're probably going to play your piano a little bit faster and a little more rhythmic than just holding notes or holding chords. So there are different perspectives of approaching music. Just understand there's a consequence. There's a series of actions and results when you get into music production. So let's start with the music. Let's open up Silenth 1. I'm going to turn my polyphony here to the max, which is 16. And you want to initialize your preset. So go to Menu, Initialize Preset. Turn your polyphony up. We're just going to use a simple super saw sound, which is 8 voices of a saw. We're going to detune it. Then we're going to add a low pass filter. Now, one of the secrets to Drake's sound is that most of his sounds feel like they're building or reversing or growing in some kind of energy, but you might not understand what that energy is. What it is that we are going to modulate the cutoff frequency of the filter. So you can hear it's muffled now, but we're going to have it kind of grow by moving that cutoff knob. So let's go there. Let's give that an envelope to tell it to move. So let's go to Mod Envelope 1, go to Cutoff A. We're going to tell it its max value here with Cutoff A. We're going to give it a nice long attack so that it feels like it's building up. Let me play a nice chord. You can see it's building up, but it's not really a note energy. It's more of it's a harmonic energy being exposed. So that's what the buildup is. Now the next trick is to crank up your resonance knob. But what we're going to do here is assign an LFO to that amount. So we're going to make this move around by itself over time using what's called an LFO, low frequency oscillator. Let's set this to free mode. Let's turn the rate to something quite slow. You can learn more about sound design at BusyWorksBeats.com/sound design. There we go over the basics to get you acquainted with plugins and what the parameters are so you're not confused. So start there if this is too much for you. Okay, so go to the menu here. We're going to select Resonance A, and we're going to turn that up. So this amount is going to move over time. And it's going to create a hollowness or a type of ringiness inside the pad. Okay, so it's very subtle, almost hard to detect, but it's moving. If I turn up the resonance, you can hear it moving. So I'm just exaggerating it so you can hear it. Okay, so now let's build out our chord progression. Now for the sound, I'm going to give it a little release. So when I hit a key, it has a nice tail to it. It doesn't just die out right away. This is good for when you change chords, so you don't have to fill in all the gaps between the chords. So the chord progression here is going to be fairly simple. Let's tap out the tempo. So you want to think very emotional tempo. Remember, most of the production drums are going to be in double. We're going to work in double time, meaning the tempo is going to be double the time of the drums. Okay, so the drums are going to be half the tempo or half time. Let's start with a nice chord. I'm going to keep it really simple. I'm not going to get into, you know, complicated chords. Let's just start out with A minor here. And create two different octaves for the bass. And now we're just going to let the sound build over time. Now, if it's moving too fast, you can always increase your attack parameter or lower your max value for your cutoff. Now what I'm going to do is play the same root notes, but play a different chord. So I'm going to play G. I might play actually, let me see. Let's try G major first. And if it sounds too generic, we'll switch out the chord. But I'm going to play the same bass notes. That was a cool chord switch. Now you can hear it go boom, like there's a little hit. What I'm going to do is activate portamento, so the pitch bends between the chords, and I'm going to activate slide mode or always mode if you're on Serum, so that the pitch will always bend between chords. It adds a little more R&B-esque tone to the chords. If I exaggerate this, you can hear it go way. That's the pitch bend effect. Also, you want to give this a little release, the envelope, so it doesn't just have that stop and go sound with the cutoff filter. And now we're going to start switching the bass notes. So when you're thinking of chord progressions and you want them to be emotional, you don't always have to move the whole chord. Sometimes you can actually hold the same notes, but change a couple notes out of the chord and it sounds different. So in this case, we're holding the same bass notes, but we're changing the top part of the chord. Okay, so that's one technique out of many. Now I'm going to create a bass movement so that it kind of leads us into the next chord. This is optional, you don't have to do it this way. So I want to go boom. Boom, boom. I don't know if I can even sing that low. But let's duplicate those notes so they're down an octave. And this is probably going to be the D minor chord. So let's just write that out. So it's the appropriate chord for the bass note. Or you could change the top chord so it doesn't match your bass notes. Let's just hear it in context. That chord switch wasn't very pleasing, and it's because the energy jump from A minor to D minor is a big energy jump. So we want to make this more fluid. A quick technique is you can invert the root note or pull that up an octave. So instead of playing it at the bottom as a root note, you can play it at the top as a leading tone. This is only one technique. Let's try it. And now the energy jump is not as drastic between this chord and this chord. So inversions are a good way to make the energy transitions between chords a little more pleasing rather than having them jump tremendously and very obviously, because you want to make it as a flowing kind of progression. So that's a pretty simple progression, but it's all in the sound design and how you approach the sound design and how long the notes are. So let's go to the playlist. Add a little reverb just to give it a little more of a wetness or an environment. Let's go to Fruity Reverb 2, turn up the decay time. So now it feels like it's in a bigger space. I'm going to cut out some of the low end from the reverb. So the reverb is adding an additional tail to the sound with a long decay curve. Here's where the percussion comes in. So let's get into the percussion. Now for the percussion, we're looking for wood blockish type percussion or hand drum percussion, but we're going to filter it so it's not as bright harmonically. So it kind of fits this kind of dark, depressed mood by mirroring those darker frequencies by cutting out the upper harmonics of a sound or cutting out most of its timbre in the higher frequencies. So let's go to batteries library, the drum library. Let's go to samples. We're going to go to drums. Let's pull up some percussion, like wooden percussion, hand drum. I like to start with wooden first. And let's see which ones we can find. That would be nice pitched correctly. So it's not tuned to the song right now. So these two work perfect, actually. That just happened to work out. But let's just send these to track two and track three. Let's pitch these as well to match the song. This should either be ding or it should be boom. So let's pitch it up. Matches better. I'm pitching that one up just a slightly. So that's going to be our snare. And we're going to place it on the 3 and the 7. If you don't know what the 3 and the 7 are, go to busyworksbeats.com/musictheory. Okay, so let's add this in. I'm going to add reverb to this so it feels like it's in a big environment, just like our pad. We're going to add Fruity Reverb 2. Let's extend that decay timeout. Let's cut out the lows. So now it has this kind of country rock vibe with that extended reverb. It's less hip-hop oriented. Now you can build the beat up. So in pattern 3, let's add the other percussion. And this is going to act almost like a drum, a kick drum. Actually, you know what we're going to do? Let's just swap them out. So instead of, let's just use these as variations. So one's pitched lower than the next. It's going to lower it in volume a bit. I mean, it's simple, but it's all about emotion. If you study 90s R&B and you listen to the chords and how the drums were laid out, that's where we got this kind of halftime thing from, is 90s R&B. Go listen to Jodeci's Forever My Lady by Jodeci, J-O-D-E-C-I. Forever My Lady is the song. Listen to how the drums are very spaced out, because I was listening to it last night when I was going to the gym, and I'm like, this is where it came from. The 90s R&B had that very slow tempo because the drums were spaced out in halftime. And that's what we're adding in modern hip-hop and R&B. So that this stuff came from a place. It's not something very new. But Jay-Z made it more popular in his album. So he's the lead of hip-hop. Him and Kanye are the big influencers of what people do in their beats. So that's where this came from. So you don't need to overly crowd your song with a bunch of drums. You know, it comes down to the vocal melody as well. You need to leave room for the artist to express whatever they're trying to express, whether that's harmonies, whether that's just a single melody. And you got to remember, you can add effects on a vocal melody as well to fill in all the dead space. You just want to leave room as a big canvas. Modernize it and make it more hip-hoppy just by adding some more drums. That's all we need from the percussion section. Let's go to busyworksbeats.com. So there's some X drums. Start with the hi-hat first. Close hi-hat X is going to be our preferred one for hi-hat rolls that we're going to create. I want to start with the hi-hat because I want to get the hi-hat rolls out of the way, because that's going to dictate the overall rhythm. So let's turn the metronome on. Let's work in context. We're in hi-hat X. So I'm going to place a hi-hat every time I want to hear a hi-hat roll. So I want to go. So I'll show you a couple of tricks. So I'm just placing where I want the hi-hat rolls to be. bang, bang. I want these to be. And I, at the end, I want a little change up. Like, I can't do it with my mouth, so we're going to have to do it digitally. But I want it to speed up and then slow down, like, you know, at the end. So let's right-click, go to piano roll. And what we need to do here is just drag these notes out. I like to hit Alt-L so that the notes are elongated for me. But also, actually, let's Control-Z that, because all these hi-hat rolls, I don't want to be super long. So actually, let's go back to this left, and let's drag each one out for however long we want the hi-hat roll to last. Change our snap degree to a half step. So I want that to only last for that amount of time. Let's hit Control-U to chop it up. And that wasn't fast enough for me, so let's switch it to quarter steps. Hit Control-U. Now that is a little too fast, so it might be in triplets. So let's go to 1/3 step and hit Control-U. And that's the kind of hi-hat roll I want. So there are small differences between those two measures, but for this song, we're going to go with the triplet chops. And I'm going to drag out the note again, hit Control-U. And the second note, I only want it to hit twice, not three times. And again, we're going to drag that out, hit Control-U. Do the same thing here for however long you want the note to last. Really, you could just copy this over instead of redoing it. And at the end, I wanted to do the triplet thing. So let's drag that out, hit Control-U. But at the end, I want the time to change. So you can either go into triplet beats, or you can go into a different timing in general. Let's try a half step. And you can hear it go, you know, it kind of changes up its speed. So that's a cool technique you can incorporate into your tracks and have a little run over, almost like accidental note rolls. So that extra hi-hat at the end will create a uniqueness about the hi-hat roll. So that's not a flaw. It's actually something intentionally done. So let's start with that hi-hat roll. Now let's go find a nice kick drum. Let's go to X drums again. Let's go to kicks. We're going to load up a nice kick. Drake's kicks are not overly done. They're just sine wave based kicks. They're not too texturized. Kick PC is perfect for this style. Now what I'm going to do with Kick PC is filter it a bit to make it smoother. So let's run this through a low pass filter. Open up our mixer. Let's open up parametric EQ 2. Let's change this to a low pass shape, cutting out the high frequencies. And you can see the harmonic spectrum is pretty extensive. So I'm going to cut out the higher frequencies, make it more of a sine wave type of shape, smoothing it out. And now we can find a snare that matches this track. Boom, boom. So I'm going to type in the kicks, and then we're going to get into the 808s. Now Drake also has a lot of back-to-back kicks, hence the song Back-to-Back. No, I'm just joking about that, but so you want to think of a lot of boom, 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 boom. Let's find a snare that matches this vibe. Let's go to snares. That one matches this vibe. Snare is going to go into 3 and the 7, not the 2 and the 4 like usual. And let's pitch the hi-hat down so it better matches the tuning of the song. Mm-hmm. you can add the 808 for more excitement. Let's go to X drums. There's a couple 808s in here. I'm going to use 808 CO. Let's open that new channel. In short, you need to tune your 808. We have a whole video called how to create 808 slides and another video, how to tune your instruments in any DAW, going in depth about tuning. So in short, we need to tune this. I'm just going to tune it to A. It's roughly tuning it. It's not fully tuning it. So let's send this to a new track. I'm going to copy the kick pattern. I'm going to paste that into a new track for the 808. And I'm going to give the 808 note values. So it doesn't play the same exact note over and over and over again. You could do that. But I like to give my 808s note values. So let me pull this up an octave as well so that we can hear the tone of the 808. And then we can always lower the octave later. The big mistake I hear a lot is out of tune 808s, and that usually occurs when you try to make your 808s in very low octaves and your ear isn't telling you it's out of tune, because you really can't detect tune at a very low frequency. It's kind of hard to distinguish. You can only really feel the bass at that point. So I like to start my bass at a higher octave and then lower it down. So I'm gonna go boom, boom. Let's start on A sharp. Now, we don't have A sharp in the music. That means this 808 is probably detuned a little from the track. So we're going to use octaves here. So it's going to go boom, boom. So we're just going to do A in two different octaves. Sounds decent as a constant note, so let's just pull that down an octave. Now, another characteristic is we're going to drag out these notes by hitting Alt L. Now, this is just for visual sake. And in the 808, let's go to the wrench tool and turn on portamento and monophonic mode. This means the notes will pitch bend between notes. And monophonic means they must overlap in order for that pitch bend to occur. If I didn't have monophonic mode on, the pitch bend would occur regardless of if the notes are overlapping or not. So I'm going to change up the 808 pattern on the second half, just as a small change up. Something else, so these may or may not clash. So you're always, the kick drum is going to dictate what the 808's doing for the most part, but it's okay to change it up every now and then. I'm going to pull that up a half step. Now for the 808, I'm going to add some distortion to the sound to give it more upper harmonic activity and more aggression. So here's where we're going to pull up Decapitator. We're going to run it through a distortion. This is a saturation plugin, but I'm going to crank it. Because I want a little more harmonic activity, so we're going to go into Punish, which is like distortion. Okay, and it gives you that aggressive Drake 808. Now also, if you want to make it that stop and go 808, go to your envelope, turn up your hold parameter. So now when you play a key, the 808 only lasts for however long your notes are. So you can create nice little stutters in your 808s. So let's customize our 808 pattern a little more. Now keep in mind, when you distort the sound, it adds upper harmonics, which may or may not be tuned to the song. So you got to be careful how you tune your 808 at this point. Has like an extra buzzy tail that isn't necessarily desirable for the sound. So I'm going to turn down the wet level a bit. Or you could pitch your 808. Since you can hear more of the harmonics, you can always change the pitch. Sounds more in. careful with the distorted sound and the overtones and make sure they're in tune. I'm going to use that 808 a lot. Now, I might create some techniques with like 808 slides. So I made pattern 7 unique, and I'm going to slide from this A to this A. You can do that with portamento, just make the notes overlap. And you can hear it goes. So if you want it to be faster, you want to turn up your slide, slower, you want to turn up your slide speed so that it's slower. And that gives you that kind of loose Drake slide. You gotta be careful though. With this much distortion, again, it's gonna almost sound out of tune. Contrast all this movement. So let's go with this steady hi-hat. And I'm going to use this on the metronome count. So t, 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 t. And that's going to be a nice contrast from all that fast movement from the closed hi-hat. So let's right-click, fill each four steps, add that in. Chords change, so we need to make sure that the 808 is matching the chord notes. Okay, so remember the chord root note changes from A, and then we change at this point to the notes F and then D. So our 808 needs to match that musical change. This is why I say everything ties back to the chord progression. Okay, so here on pattern 7, let's transpose everything. Since it's just one note, let's move this down to the note F so it matches the chord at that point. And here we go to the note D. I believe that's how we went. F and then D. Yeah, F and then D. So here in pattern 6, I'm going to make that unique, and we're just going to move this down to the note D. So I'm going to hit Control A and transpose it down to D. So now that it should match musically with the chord progression. And now I can just, copy and paste the 808s. So now they match perfectly with the chords. Something in the background kind of chiming along like ding 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 ding. So let me write out that melody just because it's in my head. I don't even know if it's in the key of the song. I'm just gonna write it out. We'll figure out the key later. That's the melody I hear in my head. Let's see if it matches with this actual chord progression. Remember, the chord changes, so it might not work for the second half of the chord. It works for the first half. Let's see for the second. Okay, so it works perfectly. Now I'm going to change out the actual sound. Now you can dig all day for cool sounds. I'm not going to spend too much time on this. I'm actually going to just use a sine wave and give it a nice decay and a release so it sounds like a ringy type of thing. I'm going to delay it a bit with time shift off the metronome. This is essentially moving the MIDI to the right, so it's delaying the MIDI without me having to go into the piano roll screen. out those percussion elements. Let's see if they fit. And we can break the song down by getting rid of the drums and then building the drums back up again. And let me turn off the monitor so we can hear this in the head. I'm going to introduce the low pass filter. I didn't want to really use it, but here I think is a cool section to use it. So I'm going to use it on everything, meaning on the master track. Now be careful how you use it on your master track, because you need to do two different things. One is to actually set the mix level automation. Actually, what am I saying? It depends on if you want a moving filter or not. So actually, we're not going to do a moving filter. So all you have to do is set your low pass filter. And then you want to right click your mix level and create automation clip. Now all you have to do is tell it to turn off at 0% and to turn on wherever you want it to turn on by right clicking points in to create 100%. So it's on at 100%, it's off at 0% automation. So only during that section it will have that effect. Now since it has a fixed cutoff, we don't have to worry about the automation knob for that cutoff frequency. You can add a little resonance if you want. Emphasize the 808 a little bit more when it kicks in, because we're just listening to the bass frequencies. Song kind of goes from nothing to something like we just did. So you can, let me see if a fade will sound better. So it's your choice how you want to kind of transition. There's no rules about it. Let's hear it twice through. Mixing would take this to a completely different level. Mixing, though, takes time, and I'm trying to keep this video as short as possible for you. You can learn how to make these Drake beats at busyworksbeats.com/Drake. We have a new course called How to Make Drake Beats, and you can learn the techniques from the OVO sounds to top charting records. many different techniques his producers use for his records. So go to busyworksbeats.com/Drake for more information. You can also click that link below. Also want to check the master pitch. Change the key of your song. See if you get a different feel with the key of your song. Now I'm going to use the master pitch knob. It may or may not affect Silent One's pitch, but this is a cool way to experiment with the different perspectives of pitch. And you can see it gives you a completely different tone. Let's just see what the drums sound like, because when you pitch up the project, it pitches the drums as well. Sounds really cool right now. Pitched right, etc. So when you do it with the master pitch knob, it's better just to do it via MIDI, but it takes more time. But that's a cool idea. You can hear it got messy when everything started hitting. But it does give you a new perspective on your song. So you can go in manually and pull down the MIDI 400 cents, which would be four notes. Okay, so you could do that manually. Step would be to add the song idea in the mind of the artist. This could be like a collab between P&D and Drake, Party Next Door and Drake, or The Weeknd, anybody who can sing really. have it. If you want to learn how to make Drake beats, you want to go to BusyWorksBeats.com/Drake or click that link below to get started now. Thanks for watching. It's BusyWorksBeats.com.